first mission I was on, I went with a different crew. The pilot was with me. The bombardier went with somebody, and I think the navigator went with somebody. The rest of the crew stayed down. They did this frequently to your first mission you made, you never made it as a crew. Nobody ever did that. So they split it up. The pilot always went with somebody else as a co-pilot to learn the system, how when you what was happening. To the colors they shoot up from different things, and the number and the name, they had all kinds of names, like New York, they would say New, and then another time they'd say York or Scramble, or that there was names like that for takeoff or start engines and takeoff and all that. Those words were always changed and different every day. So the pilot had to learn all this stuff. And so he went as a co-pilot. And his second mission, and then my second mission, and then Bombardier's second mission, we were together. And then the rest of the crew flew their first mission. And so us few had one mission above everybody else for the rest of the trip, for the rest of the time. So then the next day I flew this second mission, but the first mission was with this extra crew, and pilot was I have it in my mind, but I forget it. But it was different, and at test fire, we always test fired over the channel. And because they didn't want the cases dropping out over England. There'd be thousands of them because there'd be that many airplanes up there and test firing. So we test fired over the channel. And so short bursts, from everybody shot a short burst, and that would be two guns in my turret shooting. And my right gun, one bullet fired, and the ejector didn't pull the shell out, the case out of the firing position in the chamber. It stayed in for some reason, never figured it out, and so shell number two was pushing that shell in, so it never come out. And I couldn't charge it out, because it was already back almost as far as it'd go, because the shell, the point of the bullet that came second, was hitting the firing pin of the first shell that fired. And so it stayed there. I still see it like that today. I can still see that picture of that point on that. So I only had one gun. And I mentioned that to the pilot. He said, "Oh my God, sure you can't fix it?" I don't think so, sir. Mm-hmm. So luckily, no fighters showed up, so I didn't have to fire it anymore. But I'll never forget that, neither did he. Mance was his name, Pilot Mance. And I would notice his name would show up on the sheets that we saw of where we were in position in the formation. So that was the first mission, and went to Brunswick. So we were up almost 9 hours, and so when we got back and had our briefing, I told that bit about it, and so they of course by the time we got out from the briefing, they had already checked the turret. And they saw that, and so that when the gun was taken apart, they took the thing apart, got it out, didn't find anything. Mm. So
now you flew a full 30 missions.
Yes.
Can you tell us about some of the missions that stand out in your mind for one reason or another?
Well, there's four or five stand out. Always the first mission is a standout. That's when you learn what flak is about. You see it out there, and then you see if there's no enemy fighters out there and an airplane goes down, it's going down because of flak. So you know that, and you learn that real quick. And so the first mission is there, doesn't leave you. And most of the others don't leave either. But and our second mission was in the morning, and our third mission was in the afternoon. So we flew two missions that day. So number two and three of my tour were the same day. One and two for the rest of the crew was for the same day, and they were the administration was saying that we figured you'd like to take some missions are easier to fly than others, different places. You do two a day, get your missions over. Well,
the easy ones were called milk runs?
Yes. And so we thought you'd like to take two in one day. And that came down from headquarters, not on the base. And everybody griped. I didn't. I don't know how many in our crew griped. Didn't want to do two a day, no matter how easy they were. I felt, if they're going to be this easy, these two, I would take some more. Yeah. But that never happened again until D-Day. And then we were scheduled to go to, and I thought everybody was, just some of us went two missions on D-Day. But so the second and third missions stuck out a little bit because we did two in one day. And any others that stood out were, besides D-Day, we made a mission to Czechoslovakia. That was a long, drawn-out thing. And we had a bad airplane to begin with, and didn't know that until we took off. And we didn't get off the runway until after the grass came. I sat on all takeoffs in the, I call it a sill, at the door to the bomb bay. The door was so tall, and the bottom part of the door was about this tall. It was easy to sit on.
This is between the bomb bay and the radio room?
Yes. And I sat there with the radio operator sitting there, and I chose that spot because that's where the hatch was if anything happened on the takeoff, and you could get out. I could open, I'd be the first one at the hatch and get rid of it and be the first out. Everybody else is in the waist or the ball turret gun or the, everybody was sitting in the waist so they could get out that door. And so I sat there all the time, and I could look over my shoulder left or right, and the Bombay doors, when they close, there's always a pretty good gap there, and I could look down and see the runway. And I could see the black numbers, the black streaks for tires and that going by. And I could tell when we started to raise because the number, the stuff on the runway was getting smaller. And you could feel it, of course. But this day, I was looking there, and that dang runway stayed there. I kept seeing those black marks. And then pretty soon, I saw green. We were on the grass. We weren't going to get off. But what saved us was at the end of the runway was a track, railroad track, and it was much lower, and there was a wall on either side of it, and the land going down to the track dropped a little, not much. But it dropped enough so our wheels got off the ground. And we could get the gear up. And the pilot raised the gear as soon as he got off there long enough so that we wouldn't, there'd be no weight on the wheels and we wouldn't drop. He knew we would be still up, but we'd be going pretty straight. And if there was a house out there, we'd probably hit it, but there's nothing at the end of the runway. And so that's how we got off the runway, was that the ground dropped away, and then with the wheels up, it allowed us to get a little speed and get off the ground. It was a lousy airplane, and when we got back, I'll tell you more about that. But when we got back, he complained about the airplane during the takeoff, and he said, "I don't want to see this airplane again." And they had complaints about that airplane from other pilots, one or two, I guess. So they decided not to use it anymore, and they push it over in the junkyard, and they start using it for spare parts. 061 was the number of it. And we almost didn't get off.
Well, so you...
It was awful.
You got in the air.
We got in the air, and we went to Czechoslovakia, and that was 11 hours and 45 minutes run. And it didn't fly that well, but it got us there and back. And during that run, we had lots of planes. We had no escort. I emptied I came back with 24 rounds in the turret. And I never had that happen prior to that, or even after that. And
which means you fired your guns a lot on that mission.
We were shooting it, and they told us the next day that there were more enemy aircraft up shooting at us than there were us. There were 370 of us going to Czechoslovakia to hit this fuel depot. And not so much a depot, but a refinery. And they said there were over 400 enemy planes in the air. And going in, they were mostly, all of them, I think, but one came at us, were a single engine, 109s and 150s.
190s?
190s, I meant, yeah, 190s. And we shot a lot of those. And also going with this was a B-17 way out there following us.
Did you recognize the markings or could you
tell?
They're
too far away. Mm-hmm. And they followed us all the way in to the target.
Did you get a sense that maybe... There were Germans operating that B-17.
Yes, well, we all thought that. We talked about it a bit as we were going. Said, he's out there. And he was too far to do any real damage to it. I don't know, maybe somebody got a little closer shot at it. I was too far away to do anything to it. But we thought it was German. And we didn't have escort. So there was nobody going to attack it if we said anything.
Did you think that was up there so that it would help the Germans know what your altitude was and that kind of thing?
That and our direction.
They just got help get a bead on you.
So they would know where we were. I'm sure at one time when we turned, the last time we turned, they would know where our target was.
You know, most people are never going to see what a German fighter looks like in the air.
Yeah.
What does it look like?
It looks like an airplane. It looks like, other than knowing that it has a round engine or it's a straight inline engine, it looks like any airplane. And if they're out of ways, you don't see a star on it. and you don't know, sometimes you can't see it anyway, the position they're in. So, of course, the American planes or British planes, they never turn and aim at you. And so you know they're not going to come at you.
How could you tell if a fighter was shooting at you?
You can see the guns. If they were aiming right at you, you can see the
tracers.
The tracers. The flashing of the fire from the barrel, and then you can see from the side. You can see the smoke coming out of the off of the wing when they were firing, or on the nose of the 109. They had two large similar to 50 caliber. In the nose and 30 caliber in the wing to aim the cannon.
The 20 millimeter?
20 millimeter cannon. So you can see that.
And how, for people who don't understand how a group of B-17, and you, of course, were in the 94th bomb group, were you in a particular squadron?
Well, our four squadrons, our three squadrons would fly.
But which squadron were you in?
331st.
And the element that, were there nine planes in the element?
Yeah, there would be six. There were groups of six all over. Sometimes there were nine in there, and never knew when it was going to be nine.
And that whether it was six or nine in that element, how close would the planes fly to each other?
Quite close, 50 feet, 100 feet apart.
Was that to kind of consolidate, make it more difficult for the fighters to come through the element?
That and concentrate the fire.
As the fighters are... How would you know if you hit a fighter?
Well, you can see it sometimes if they're close enough. Like the two I got, one was at 109, and I had a lucky shot and hit, and one shell or two went in the radiator. Well, white stuff comes out of the radiator in the back, and you know it's not going to come back. He's going to get down as fast as possible or bail out. And you never see that.
How, you know, obviously you're on the bottom of the airplane. Where did this FW-190, where did it come from? Did you know it was coming?
Yeah,
did somebody call it out?
He was coming from below, headed right for us.
And you spotted him?
Yeah, he was way out there. My first round of burst, he was a good 800 yards out there, but I shot at him anyway. And it was the second burst that I saw the white stuff come out.
But you weren't able to see what happened to the plane because
no,
he just went off with his trailing smoke.
He's trailing water.
Vapor. Yeah.
Vapor.
Yeah. Well, you know, did you see B-17s go down that day?
Yes. Yeah, we lost 47 out of the big group. But we were so busy shooting at so many airplanes with no escort that there wasn't much time to stop and watch something.
And I guess that's a question is under a scenario like that where, I mean, you're in full-fledged combat at that point. A lot of things are happening. How do you control the fear? How do you not turn into those two guys that were on that plane with you that time? I mean, how do you control the panic, you know, or what's going on with you at that time?
Well, you're... For me, there was no panic. I was just wondering when they were going to stop coming in, and wondering if I was going to make it, and how long my ammo was going to last, because it was so much going in that we had never seen before, The earlier missions, we see a few planes fire three or four times at one or something like that, maybe not see any more. But this day, there was no escort, and there were so many out there, they were constant. It was about a 2.5 hour run to get to the target with those guys coming in. They hit us as we went over Belgium, and it didn't stop till we got to Czechoslovakia. Now that's a ways to go, and they were coming and coming and coming. It was awful.
Were you trained to? I mean, again, most people wouldn't know how to use a 50 caliber machine gun. Were you trained to use like bursts?
They start telling you that as soon as you're a gunner.
So you're not doing like 2 minutes of just constant fire?
Oh no! If you did that, you would have no ammo.
How long would a typical burst take?
A burst is just seconds.
Well,
4 or 5 seconds. And that's quite a few shells.
You know, as you went through missions like this, were you, what was your feeling about the ball turret position? I mean, were you still okay with it? Was it, you know?
Yeah, it was that or walking on the ground or riding in a tank.
Because I mean, I'm sure you heard people say, look, the guy you switched with didn't want to be in the ball. Certain people did not want to be in the ball anymore.
Well, that's why I switched.
Right.
He didn't want to be in the ball.
I guess in a way I'm asking, you didn't mind being in the ball given all you knew about it.
No, I was.
Because you're locked in there, you know. Once that plane goes, that hatch comes down,
you don't get out unless you have to, and you don't want to get out if you have to, because that means you're either going to bail out or you've been hit and you have to get out. So I'd rather be able to stay in there and complete the trip than I know I'm safe.
You know, on an 11-hour, you know, that long mission to Czechoslovakia, now here's a question people feel funny about asking, but I'll ask it anyway. How do you go to the bathroom?
Well, normally there's a relief tube in the bomb bay. Single guys go up there. I would, my first mission, I held it the whole damn mission. I didn't want to get out of the turret. I didn't want to leave it that long. So I went to the junkyard and got a relief tube. Got the funnel, left about 3 feet of the rubber that's cemented to it, cut off a piece about 3 foot long there and give it a snip so I could, in my turret, put the gun straight down and use the put the hose out the chute for at the bottom of underneath the guns where the case is dropped. I could reach that and put the hose down there, then I would relieve myself with that hose hanging out. Later on, they put one light in there.
But you were able to stay in the turret then.
I stayed in the turret. Mm-hmm. It didn't take long to relieve myself, and then I pull it, bring it back up and leave it on the floor of the turret in case I needed it again.
The other question, I guess, was how cold did it get up there?
Well, it was always cold. I always say minus 30 was a warm day. And it was cold. We had electric heated suits. Now, when they first started flying in early 1942, the first missions were in August. The first mission was August 17th in 1942. And for the rest of 1942, they didn't have heated suits. And I assume they didn't get them that fast because the guys were freezing. They had more frostbite than guys getting hit with bullets or flak, and so they had to satisfy that problem immediately. So they quickly, starting in the F model, they put heated suits and a circuit in there for heated suits. And I don't know when it started, before that. Maybe some E models had them, and I don't know. I don't know how soon that period went through from August till December of 42.
But you had electric suits.
But we had electric suits.
And were all your missions in the G model?
No, my first couple of missions were in F models. Uh-huh. They still had a few of those when we got there. Not many.
Back to that mission in Czechoslovakia, I'm assuming you dropped your bombs, and then anything eventful on the way back?
Yes, just more airplanes. Instead of single-engine fighters, while we were on the bomb run, we saw twin-engine fighters out there forming up to come at us. And so as soon as we got off the bomb run and away from some of the flak, they were hitting us. They didn't come through the flak very much because they don't want to get hit by flak either, and there's a ton of us there. Once in a while, an airplane would fly through and try to hit somebody, but not many. But they were out there as soon as we got off the target run and dropped the bombs. Those twin-engine fighters were at us, and they attacked us like they were single-engine fighters. They came in and dove at us. And in fact, there was a very popular picture taken from another group that was with us, a Square H, which is a 380th bomb group. There's a wing, the right wing, shows the H, which is where the letters on the wing were on the right wing. The left wing was a star, and it shows that H there, and here's a twin-engine 410 just pulling away from his pass at this airplane. And he's close, as close or closer than some 109, some single-engine fighters came. Mm-hmm. And that's the way they were coming at us on the way out.
You remind me another question. What was the letter in your group on your planes?
We had Square A.
And so they hit you on the way in, and they hit you on the way out.
On the way out, yeah. And the single engine fighters went down, refueled, and came back up on the way out. And we still had single engines coming at us. They hit us first going in over Brussels. That's when the 109s first started, and they all had yellow noses, the most of them. And that was the group that Goring had specialized, and they called them the Goring's yellow nose bastards. And there were a bunch of yellow noses coming at us to begin with, and then there were others that came in after that, going into the target, and some after. Yeah, they were just all over the place. And the big group of 370 lost 47. So there were quite a few going down. I didn't see many because I was too busy.
Well, that was a memorable mission.
A very memorable. That was the worst mission for fighters. Mm-hmm. We had other missions with fighters at us, but not more than, say, 10 minutes or 15 minutes, something like that. Four or five passes, or maybe 10, but it was awful. Everybody felt the same way I did. They were so happy when that damn mission was over. God.
Were there... I feel funny asking at this point. That alone was enough. Were there other missions that stood out in your mind for some reason?
Another one that was enemy-wise was a flak mission over Berlin. The first mission over Berlin, it wasn't bad. It was just normal, lots of flak, not tons of it. And maybe four or five fighters, something like that, just a normal mission, except an airplane that was supposed to be on our right in the formation had drifted over and gotten on our left and down a ways. And I noticed he was gone, and I saw him over here on our left. And when we got on the bomb run, I noticed he was starting to, I say drift, because I don't know if he was moving on purpose or he was drifting. He's coming back to, I guess, his position. I don't know if he was trying to get in position or he was just drifting. I don't know. Because pretty soon he came under us and we were on the bomb run. And I said, I told the bombardier, I said, don't drop. And it was just before we had a drop. I don't know. I guess I just said, don't drop, because in case we were dropping within the next two or three, a couple of minutes, because he was drifting. He was coming very slowly, and it was going to take a couple of minutes for him to get past us out here a ways. And so I knew within those 2 or 3 minutes, 2 minutes, that if we dropped bombs, we would probably hit him. And as he went under, I told the pilot, bombardier, not to drop. And he looked and he said, God, yes. he can see. So he couldn't drop when the bombs did drop. So when the bombs dropped, I was watching him go over and go underneath. And pretty soon a damn bomb came down not too far from us and hit him.
Where did it hit him?
Hit him on the left elevator. No, the right elevator. And it didn't come off. It came up alongside the airplane. But he started down. And he went down fast. The bomb didn't explode. The bomb hit him flat on there. There's pictures of this. There's 8 pictures. I have 5 of them. The other 3 didn't show anything because we were over clouds part of the time. And on the last 3 pictures, he was below the clouds. There was a big cloud there. Didn't cover everything. It was just a big enough cloud to cover him up as he dropped. And so there's no pictures of him under the clouds. So I have the 5 that show the bomb just split second above the elevator, and the next one shows the elevator off, or up along the rudder, and it was and him going down.
Now, did you take the pictures?
No.
Somebody.
The pictures were taken by the airplane that dropped the bombs. Now, every mission, they put 5 or 6 cameras in the camera well, which is under the radio room. You never knew. Sometimes they'd tell you that you had a camera in their camera well. You had nothing to do with it. It was automatic. And maybe you knew it, maybe you didn't. I don't remember taking cameras. And so we didn't have a camera that day. And the airplane that took the bombs, or took the pictures, was above us in another group of 6 or 9. I don't know how many it was at that moment. I'd have to look at the thing. We have flight plans, and I got copies of them after the war, of all our position in the particular mission, that mission. So. And it shows him being on our right. We were flying off Mance, and we were left, and he was right. But when we got to the target, he was on the left. And then he drifted back. And then, and those pictures show him drifting, because it showed when he was hit, he was over the street pattern of Berlin. He was right over it, and it showed him with the bomb just about to hit him. It showed him about maybe a foot above it.
I've seen the photos. I know what you're talking about.
And the next one shows that thing up. But it shows how he moved, because each picture is 6 seconds apart. And it shows him when he was hit, he was over that diamond in the street pattern. And the next picture, he was over a ways, and he was under us more. In 6 seconds later, he was over somewhere else. By then, he was going down. People reported at briefing that they saw it, and they said he spiraled down, and a wing came off. I watched it. When he went beyond the clouds, nobody saw him after that, and no wing came off, and I saw him dropping straight. And so I made a different report than everybody else. And when the pictures were printed after we got there, and the two pilots of the airplane that dropped the bombs was called in to the CO's home on the base after dinner, when they finally got the pictures printed, they say, "What do you know about this?" And they said, "We know nothing." And they didn't. But there was no conversation. I didn't hear any conversation on it, only between us on the airplane. And there was nothing in between airplanes. So how some people could say that the airplane, the wing come off and it spiraled down. No, he didn't. He went straight down and below there, and he hit in Berlin, and he hit with all wing as a full airplane.
Once that plane dropped through the cloud cover, was that the last you saw the plane?
That's the last I saw of anybody shot. I don't think anybody could see it after that.
And this was solid cloud cover. There wasn't, you know, breaks in the clouds.
Well, further away, there was a big cloud under the airplanes that were there. But over there was, you could see there was the ground and that kind of, in the picture. There was some out around. But this all happened so fast. Just a few minutes, less than a few minutes, because each picture was 6 seconds apart, and the fifth picture shows him with wing on above the cloud. He's not going to spin after that.
Well, tell us about then this other mission to Berlin.
Okay, the second mission to Berlin was the worst we had of flak. Now, we've always had flak, and it was close, and we felt it here and there, and come back with a few holes. But this mission to Berlin, for some reason, there are a few other planes got shot up as much as we did, but for the whole damn run, going in and out, The flak was hitting us, like they were aimed right at us. They weren't, but it seemed that way, because I could see. I had a top of my turret. I had a little window, so when my turret guns were level, I could look up and see inside the waist position. I could see the radio door and maybe his arm or foot, and I could look around the airplane. And more than once I looked up when the flak was flying so damn fast and thick, I could see a hole appear on one side of the airplane and another hole over here as a piece went on through it at the top. And there was, when we got back, there were 400 holes in the airplane. Nobody hurt, part of that flak, one of the pieces was quite long and quite wide, ended up in our number two fuel tank, and because it was so big, it wouldn't seal. And my job is to look underneath when flak's flying and report anything I might see that would disturb the flight of the aircraft and so on. And so I was looking around, and luckily I was looking out the right down the left wing. All of a sudden, fuel started coming out of the turbo. Full. I mean, it was like a fire hose was shooting fuel out of the tank. And it was, you could see the shape of the fuel dropping around, how it comes out of the turbo, around the way the turbo's constructed. And as soon as I saw it, I told the pilot to feather number two. Now, if he'd asked me a question, we'd have blown up. He took me at my word. He didn't say anything. He just must have nodded, or with his hand told the co-pilot to push that red button for number two. Because immediately after I said it, within a couple of seconds, that prop started slowing down. Well, as soon as it stopped, the pilot said, "Why, it's running fine." And it was. All the instruments were correct and everything's functioning. But I told him, he said, "Why?" And I told him what it was. And his answer was, "Good God." And that's all he ever said to me. He didn't say anything else.
Saved the airplane.
If he'd have asked questions, we'd have been gone.
Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if you had any more about that mission. The question I was going to ask, at some point, I'm assuming you're doing a countdown to number 30. I mean, is that true?
Well, somewhat. You know,
I mean, did you knew on your 30th mission that was your last mission? Right?
Yeah.
Was that an eventful mission, or was it just another routine one? Or,
well, it wasn't routine because I was wounded.
Well, tell us about that mission.
We were over the target run, over Munich. And my guns were straight down, and we're on the run. And I'd look around occasionally, and then I'd put the guns back down again because it was flak flying pretty good. And I wanted to be ready to open the door, the hatch, if I was going to stop. And then I'd raise it again, and I'd look around. And then I'd drop it again for another 3 or 4 seconds. The bomb run is 5 minutes. So I balanced it out of putting it down and then not having it down too long, because somebody looking out there might think that it was a bad turret and come through the flak and hit us. And so I constantly moved. And while I was down one time, the flak hit my turret. I heard it hit the turret, and within a split second, I felt it hit me. Now, my right foot pushed the button to talk to the crew. That's the communication button. My left foot controlled part of the sight. It was the thing that my sight had, it was electrical. It didn't have a circle and a dot. It had a horizontal line and a line up and down on each end. The left side, the line went down, the right side it went up. And my left foot then moved these in and out. So when they were way, if they were a long way away, the wings, you judged the width of the wing or the nose to the tail of this airplane you're looking at. So when you first look at the airplane, he's way out there, and so his wings are further away, and so your two lines are closer together. And as he gets closer, you raise your foot and widen the lines, so you'd be pretty close to what the you won't be exact, but you're keeping close to them. So your computer sight is working. So as I was hit on the flak, my right foot came off with my leg, came off my speaking connection. And I couldn't tell anybody I was wounded.
And you were hit in the right leg.
I was hit in the right leg. It came through. Luckily, it came through. There's a little spot so wide and in between two windows that's metal, the cast aluminum. And it hit that little thing and slowed it down. If it had been forward or back another couple inches, it would have gone through glass or plexiglass, and that would have gone through faster and done more damage. So that saved my leg.
Did it hit?
I almost lost it anyway.
Did it? What part of the right leg did it hit?
Between the knee and the hip. And it smashed that bone from my knee to the hip into small pieces. They said the biggest piece was about an inch long.
Did you stay conscious?
Oh, yeah, I was conscious.
And had you dropped the bombs yet?
No.
No. So, well, take us through the rest of the mission. What happened?
Well, my foot was not on there, and I couldn't talk to him until after the bombs had been dropped, and I could finally get my foot back down on, so I could hardly move my leg. And it took a long time for me to, and I had nothing long that I could push the with my hand and push the button. So there was a good, I'd say, 5 minutes, maybe more, before I could tell the pilot that I had been wounded. And so as soon as I told him, he said, well, we'll get you out of there. Because I was blood on my turret, on the glass, and my suit, my electric suit was soaking up. And they pulled me up, and one of the my buddy in the waist position got in the turret. He's 6'2", so I know that somebody can sit in there at 6'2". And he flew the rest of the mission. And then he had another mission to do on his own the next day. And so they pulled me out, and the radio operator and the right waist gun guy got me into the got me into the radio room and laid me out. And in order to put a tourniquet on me to stop the blood, they had to take my heated suit off. It's cold up there. So I didn't wear, like a lot of guys did, they wore long johns under their pants and shirts. Well, I never did, because I said if I got shot down and bailed out or we crash landed, I didn't want to run around the city or in long johns. I want to be in pants. And so I never did wear long johns. I had them, but I never wore them. And I just bought a new pair of pants and shirt, suntans, that weren't GI type. They're a little better and fit better and felt better on you. And I bought those, and they threw them away.
Well, it, it sounds like they got a big hole in them.
Well, there was a hole in the leg, and but there was blood all over both things, my shirt, tail, and that. So when I got out, when they took me out of the turret and laid me in the radio room, they had to take my clothes off so they could, because the big hole was up a ways, but because it was, the piece hit me was about 3 inches long and hit sideways to the bone instead of as it went through, as it, the hole was smaller going through the turret, but evidently it turned before it hit me as it went through the metal part. Because the doctors, when they were looking at me, says, we don't know if we can save this or not. And so the hole was pretty good size in my leg. I looked down, I could see it. It looked like the size of a large dollar, silver dollar. And I can still see that. That looks like a large silver dollar. The hole, the silver dollar would fit in it.
Because the flak went all the way through. It's
yeah,
not still
it, in came, your it came through, it hit the bone and turned and pointed out to where the front part of about a quarter of an inch, the radio operator pulled it out. Now, there were other pieces in there from either the shell or the flak or pieces of turret that were in there. When they took x-rays, there were 13 pieces in there, they said they could count. They said, it's up to you. We can dig them out if you want, or you can leave them in and they'll probably disappear. If you dig them out, you're going to be twice as bad as you are now, because they have to dig a lot and destroy more flesh. I said, leave it in. no question. Because it was small enough that it wouldn't bother me. There were five large ones, fairly large, but the rest of them were quite small. Because when I take x-rays now, there's still three pieces still in there. Mm. Two disappeared since the war. And
so this was your last your last mission for true reasons. It was number 30, and you were severely wounded.
Yeah. So they finally got the stuff. They took all my clothes off and put a tourniquet on it. Then there's always, in the radio room, there's a bag that you can plug in. It's not a sleeping bag. It's just a square bag. And you have to double up your legs and to get in it. And it will plug in. It has lines in it, so it'll warm you up, keep you from freezing.
Have they given you a morphine shot?
Oh, yeah. The radio operator gave me a morphine shot, and he says, this hurts me more than it does you. He had a smile on his face when he did it. But, yeah, he gave me. So I had one of those. And so I rode the rest of the way home. It was we were over Munich, and we were up about 9.5 hours. So it was a good 4 hours back there. And they stopped the blood pretty good. It didn't leave too much new blood when I got out. When the doctors came in to look at me before they pulled me out, they saw what blood was there. And so when I got in the ambulance to go to the hospital, I thought it was going to be close, but it was 30 some odd miles away. It was a long time going. And they put a, what they call it?
A stretcher or something?
It's just liquid, clear liquid.
An IV?
It's an IV, but plasma. It wasn't blood replacement. It was a plasma. And I didn't have a transfusion. They thought that I was okay. I wasn't too white yet. And so they said, we'll see if you could go without a transfusion. We'd rather not have to give it to you. Safer, better for you if you can survive without it. And they also said, it's up to you what happens to this leg. Now, when they question you about your health, how you been and all that, they ask if you're a smoker or a drinker. And I was neither one, and the doctors knew that, and they said, if you survive this, it's because you haven't smoked or you don't drink very much.
And so you...
So they gave me 2 weeks. They said, well, if you haven't recovered enough with his bone repair on its own, if it doesn't show up good enough, we'll have to do something. We don't know what we haven't planned yet. And so at the end of 2 weeks, they took x-rays every other day just to see how I was doing. And by the time we got up to 2 weeks, they were looking pretty good. Each x-ray was a little better. And so at the end of 2 weeks, they said, well, we think you're going to be all right. Just don't get up for another 2 weeks. Stay in bed for another 2 weeks. So I stood in bed for that time before I could walk around on crutches.
You're in a cast?
I had a cast on it, yeah. And it was only a half cast because they wanted to be able to get to the bone. And so I had a half cast in bed. And then they said, well, now you can get up on crutches and take your cast off.
Take us through the rest of the story. I'm assuming you got home somehow.
Sure. Well, I was in the hospital for a couple more weeks, walking around, getting stronger. They finally sent me back to the base, and I was there under minimum duty, and they couldn't send me home until I was well enough to be called Class A, so if I went to some base, I could serve. If they couldn't send me as long as I was disabled in any amount of time, of whatever, 2%, 10%, whatever, I had to be 100% ready to fly again or to go on duty. So they sent me home on the 15th of September. And I was wounded on the 13th of July. So all that time was recuperating.
Did you fly back or take a ship?
Fly back? Gee whiz. I wasn't a Class A. No, I went on ship. I left the base by myself, and I had my... medical records. I had my own 201 file, and I'd never seen it before other than when somebody was writing in it. And so it was open, and I had it in my duffel bag, and I was going to go on train by myself and go home, go to Scotland and get on a ship and go by myself. And so I took advantage of, when I was on the train, I opened up my 201 file, see what they had in there. And for the medical, they had there that very seriously wounded. But when my folks got the cablegram, they just said seriously. So at first, they considered me in worse shape. And then because my folks didn't get a cablegram till the day after they got my letter. I wrote a letter, and they got it before they got a cablegram from Washington, D.C. And so they knew I'd been wounded, but didn't know how much, or because I didn't write it. I wrote very little. I just said I was wounded. I'm in the hospital for a while, and I'm okay. So when I read that, I said, but geez, I was worse off than I thought. So,
which ship did you end up taking back?
Fortunately, when I got to the dock, incidentally, when I was shipping out, went to Barry St. Edmunds, got on the train, and one of the conductors or the guys that took tickets and all said, why don't we put your bag up in the baggage car rather than keeping it with you? So, I'll keep this part, and you can put those two up there, okay. And my bags did not get off when I got out. And before I could holler and say, hey, where are my bags, train took off. So I had to follow that train so I could get my bags. Took me all night to where I caught up with the bags, and they finally got them out. Then I got on the train and went back to where I was supposed to get on the bus, or get on the boat. Yeah, and I thought I'd never get them. I thought I'd be there 6 months chasing my bags.
Which ship was it?
I got on it's a big ship, World War I type, four-stacker. It was the sister ship to the Lusitania that was sunk by the Germans to put us into war.
Just the Mauritania?
It was four-stacker, and it went by itself. It was fast enough, and we went zigzagging again back to New York when
Sorry,
I got off.
Do you remember the name? Was it the Mauritania?
No, it was the Aquitania.
The Aquitania.
Aquitania.
So you got back. Did you get 30 days leave?
Yeah.
What did you do with that 30 days? I mean, were you able to get home, or was that?
Oh yeah. They gave me travel time too, because I was going from New York to L.A. And I went on train and took 7 days, went through San Francisco to get to L.A. Didn't go south. I was north. So I saw stuff I'd never seen before, northern states and northern country and all that. And I came down from San Francisco to L.A.,
What was the homecoming like?
Well, they didn't know exactly when I was going to get there. And I didn't have a phone, no cell phones. And so I surprised them. I got off in L.A., took the red car, which was a streetcar, down to L.A. or Long Beach. Got on Long Beach, the bus that went by our house, or near our house, and I carried my bags and walked in the door. Surprised mother. Dad was working.
She was glad to see you, I bet.
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah.
Well, you got home safe, pretty battered, but you were home. How long did you stay in the military?
I stayed till the end of the war. Like, you're into to the end of the war.
You didn't flirt with the idea of staying in the military?
I said I would, but they said, you'd been wounded, we don't want you. Too soon. Now, maybe later, we want to make sure you're healthy.
What kind of work did you do after the war?
Well, I was in college when I left, and when I came back, when I got off, I was discharged in Riverside, or San Bernardino at the big base there, and I took the red car to Long Beach and I went home. And I got home in the afternoon. It was on Thursday. And I said, gee, I better check and see what's going on at school. So I called that afternoon, called in the phone book. I called up the phone number that they had there. I said, I want to get back in school as soon as possible. And what's the schedule? What's going on? And the gal says, well, tomorrow's your last day for late signups. When you sign up, when you're in school and you're going for about a month or so, you have three or four weeks there. You can drop a class and take another one. And that was the last day you could make any changes in a thing, or the last day you get in class. So I got up the next morning before I could go get some civilian clothes and went to school in my uniform, even though I was discharged. And I went to class that day.
And so what kind of work did you do after the war?
Taught school.
Ah! what level did you teach?
I taught eighth grade.
And what subject did you teach?
Most of the time, I taught general subjects for a while, but I taught music and history, eighth grade.
And how many years did you teach?
33.
When you look back on your time in service, look back on your time in World War II, are you proud of your time in service?
What was that again?
When you look back on your time in service, were you proud of your time?
Oh, yeah.
And tell me why.
Well, there was so much even stuff going on that day that they were wondering what was going to go on. And I felt that I'd done a good job what I did and survived, and we won the war.